lollygaggers. Another week on tap. Little Metallica getting us started tonight. We are Lollygagging Sports. As always, I'm Bo Reed, along with my fellow lollygaggers, Samantha Bunten and Matthew Irby. We're going to be talking some divisional round playoffs, and we're going to hop back into that time capsule. But first things first, Samantha, how you doing?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Doing well. I have no complaints. Everything seems to be going okay down here. How about you, Irby?
I'm really good down here. After work, headed out to the backyard, and I made 3 extra points in 4 tries. So I'm doing good.
Ooh, okay. Now, is this a tryout? Was Jerry there? Because obviously Mike McCarthy's not going to be there, but was Jerry Jones there?
You know what? No. Once I made 3 out of 4 and not 2 out of 4, Jerry was no longer interested.
That's about right.
I mean, what did they say? Anyone who's 5'7" and lives in Texas? Like, I mean, technically, you know, you've met the criteria.
5'7". That's interesting. You just have to be 5'7".
Yeah. I'm not sure how they arrived at that point, but that's, yeah. They said anyone who's 5'7" and lives in Texas. And I'm like, well, it's going to be a lot of people. But, you know, okay.
I'm a little, it's a little unsettling, though, that they limited it to just Texas. I mean, what if somebody could afford the airfare to get to Dallas and they had a better leg? You're stuck with the Texas person.
That's true. Or they were 5'6".
Or they're 5'6".
That would be Jerry right there. Jerry, you seen this guy? Yeah, I know, man. He's nailing all these 50 yarders. Yeah. How tall is he? 5'6" and a half. Yeah, I'm out.
Too short.
And this is why Dallas is not going to win the Super Bowl.
Hey, now wait a minute. We haven't picked that game yet. That's 4 games from now in the show. Let's not tip some hats here.
I feel confident in my pick.
Okay. Let's dive into this. 4 divisional round matchups, 2 on Saturday, 2 on Sunday. No Monday night fun for everybody this week, but we do get the divisional playoffs. Let's start with the first one on Saturday, Samantha. The Jaguars, fresh off of yet another comeback win, go to Kansas City. I'm just going to go out on a limb here, but I think it would behoove the Jaguars to actually participate in the first half of this one.
The Chargers are unique animal in the worst way, and that they are incredibly creative in the depth and breadth of the ways that they can find to lose a football game. I don't think that you can make the assumption that Kansas City is going to just allow you to, like, I don't know, steamroll them in the second half of a football game. Like, that's just not how this is going to go, right? So they're going to have to show up. They're going to have to play 2 halves if they want to have a prayer of winning this. I mean, it's got an incredible gift for a team that didn't really earn a gift in the first round by getting matched up with the Chargers, who have what I call San Diego syndrome. They did come from there relatively recently, so San Diego syndrome, like, these teams can do, like, the Padres, man. Like, they will find a way. They will find a way. Like, whatever it is, something will go wrong. 17 things will go wrong. So I don't think you can count on the Chiefs to show up and hand you the same 30 minutes of freebies. So good luck to the Jaguars.
Is this like the China syndrome, the San Diego syndrome?
What's China syndrome? Is that a thing?
It was a thing. Interesting enough, this happened. Irby, correct me if I'm wrong on any of this. When 3 Mile Island happened, it was right after the movie The China Syndrome came out, and it was about, essentially, I think, Irby, it was how a nuclear meltdown could conceivably burn a hole to China through the middle of the earth. So I guess it does make sense. I guess the San Diego syndrome would be the same as the China syndrome about implosion.
So you're implying they could be connected, which might not be wrong. So you're saying if there were a nuclear test site that we did not know about somewhere near San Diego that burned a hole to China and somehow brought something up from the center of the earth that has caused all of its sports teams to massively fail. I mean, I don't know. I'm not out on that theory. I have to tell you, I don't hate it.
Yeah, but that's, I don't hate it. Frankly, it could explain it. I wish you to, you have to prove it wrong, Irby. You got any proof that, that this isn't the case? Because if not, then we've got an we got an actual theory here.
I no. If anything, you've given me a headache because I deal with radiation conversations all day long at work. And you literally just brought it into the podcast. That was amazing. Well done, throwing the China syndrome. Wow. I probably will have to watch that movie tonight now. Mm-hmm. Just good, but good explanation. Yes, that is correct. Some issues there with geography, but you know, whatever. That's a lot. That is the charger. Yeah, issues with geography. Yeah, but whatever. It probably doesn't sound as good to say something like the Mongolian syndrome or the Tonga syndrome. It's like that doesn't sound as great. Like, so let's blame the bad guy. Yeah, there you go. all in all, to say, yeah, Jacksonville. Let's play a first half. Yeah. That would be good. That would be good. This is and it'll be interesting because this is the second time these two will have played. They did play in Kansas City earlier, back when Jacksonville finally then took a week off and decided, oh, let's win 8 of our next 9. That's worked out pretty well for them. And it was also a game that they did the exact same thing. Yeah. Kansas City had a 20-0 lead in that game. 20-0. They ended up only winning by 10, so here we go again, Jacksonville. I don't want to say it's that simple. You just need to play both halves, and you'll win the game. I know that seems like a very logical, simple statement, but sometimes the most simple things need to be said.
It would also help to not throw 4 interceptions in the first half. Samantha, let's talk about the Chiefs here, because obviously they're the favorites, and they should be the favorites because they are the better team. I don't see really much chance. I mean, I'll give the Jags a little bit of a chance because they were able to make it to the divisional round of the playoffs, but it's not much of a shot. So how can, let's flip this around, because normally it's, you know, how can Team X beat Team Y? How could the Chiefs screw this up? Because I think that's what's going to have to happen here for the Jaguars to win this game, is the Chiefs are going to have to do something stupid.
Overconfidence. Like, don't assume because you have a 2-score lead going into halftime that you're done, that you can just sit back and rest on your laurels. So now, typically, I don't think this is something that has been an issue for the Chiefs, particularly. They're way more likely to come back in the second half and get you than to lay down a diet. But if you want to know how you lose this game, if you're Kansas City, it's you go up a couple scores in the first half, and then you shift into prevent and rest on it and assume that you've won a football game. And so I think Jacksonville, as much as I don't think there's any equating what one can do to the Chargers with what one can do to the Chiefs. Like, there's a reason we play the games, right? So, like, I don't think we can assume that just because they are less likely to be a victim of this than the Chargers, that they're completely immune to anything the Jaguars can do. So, you know, if the Jacks can keep it relatively close and not just get completely blown out in the first half, then, yeah, Kansas City, like, gotta look alive, gotta stay alert, and they're not a terribly complacent team, but we have seen them lapse into this at various points, and that's what I think might be your undoing if you are the Chiefs. Otherwise, you know, I mean, I don't think from an X's and O's, from a matchup standpoint, I don't think the Jaguars have much of a chance here, mm-hmm. But anybody has a chance against any NFL team, like we've discussed a million times, they're all really good, even the bad ones. So anybody in the postseason can be anybody else in the postseason if somebody gets lazy and arrogant partway through a football game.
Irby, same question for you. How can the Chiefs screw this up?
I turn the ball over early, have a lot of 3-and-outs, play outside yourselves. You know, the first two are pretty obvious for everybody, but that would be, let's focus on the third. Kansas City, just be yourself. Don't do anything crazy. You know, we don't need any of these. You don't need a trick play. You don't need any no-look passes. You don't need any of that stuff. Just be yourself. Play the game that you've been playing. Be the team that got you 14 wins in the regular season, and you're going to be fine. Like, this absolutely is a game of Jacksonville has to play above themselves. Jacksonville needs something. They need a spark. They need a play. They have to have it. Toe-to-toe, if you just go back and forth, you will beat them. But if you give them hope, if you give them opportunity, yeah, you can lose, absolutely.
Yeah. You know, Smith, I don't really just – I guess that could be a rule of thumb for me. Is like the halftime score is not something I pay a lot of attention to, unless it's ridiculous, right? If a team's up by four touchdowns at the half, I'm going to notice that. This is a game where I'm actually probably going to pay a little bit closer attention to that halftime score because I've seen what both of these teams do in the second half. Who needs to be up here? Is this a situation where the Jaguars need to be up knowing what the Chiefs do in the second half, or is there more pressure on the Chiefs to be up at halftime because of what Jacksonville has been doing consistently over the last few weeks?
You know, that's an interesting question. I'm inclined to say it's the Chiefs, not because I think the Jags have the upper hand, even if that is what's happening. It's more that if the Jags are up, I don't know, 7 at the half, I'm still going to feel pretty confident that Kansas City is going to get it done, right? But if the Chiefs are up at the half, then I'm thinking, uh-oh, Jacksonville, like, you better have another half like the one you played a week ago, right? You. So, it's, yeah, I mean, the onus remains on the Jags, which is kind of what makes it an interesting question. But at the same time, they are playing with house money. They have nothing to lose, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So if they're down at the half, if they're up at the half, whatever happens after that, like, unless you just completely embarrass yourselves, which I don't think is going to be the case, you've either got a hard-fought loss in a season where you should never have gotten this far, or you've pulled off the biggest upset of the postseason. It's win-win. But if you're the Chiefs, man, if you're down at the half, you're thinking about what happened a week ago, what Jacksonville did a week ago to the Chargers, and you're getting nervous, right? So I almost feel like in that respect, it's almost more on the Chiefs in that regard.
Watch the play to a 3-3 first half tie.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is watch. Yeah, it'll be tied.
Irby, anything you add to that before we pick them?
No, it's a great point of just, you know, it goes back to the being yourself and Kansas City. You don't have to do anything too crazy here. The weird thing about Kansas City this season, Jacksonville, you know, and we'll throw a lot of luck factor at us, man. I know you're big on that. You know, Jaguars had they were a +5 in the turnover differential this season. Amazing how they wiped that out in one playoff game. But a lot of that stuff was fumble-related, takeaways and giveaways. A lot of fumbles involved with Jacksonville this season. Kansas City, for all the good, for all the 14-3, for all this stuff, man, they were a negative turnover differential this year. Just a lot of turnovers, a lot of giveaways. And in that game against Jacksonville, they were a -3 as well. They turned the ball over 3 times and still won. So, again, I mean, that's why this really is a simple formula. Protect the ball. Don't do anything too crazy, and you're going to be fine. And that's where this is what we love about playoffs. You know, almost in any sport, especially the NFL, especially baseball, too, we talk about this, too. Because it's that simple of a formula, yeah, something crazy is probably going to happen then.
All right, let's pick this one then. Samantha, who do you have? Jags or Chiefs?
The Chiefs. Although I think it's really important to acknowledge, like, Irby, you know, you made a really good point. You brought it up kind of twice there about, like, the Chiefs, like, don't get cute. You know, you mentioned the no-look passes. Like, mm-hmm. don't be doing, you know, this is not a game in which you should be taking unnecessary risks. And if they start doing stuff like that, then we're going to see a shift here. But I trust the Chiefs ultimately to get the job done, and I think they are the better team.
Irby, how about you? What do you got here?
Yeah, same pick for me, Kansas City. I know Jacksonville is my adopted team, and I'll cheer for them, and they're fun to watch, and that was a great job last week. And if you play 2 halves, you're going to be in this ballgame. But Kansas City with a week off, Kansas City with Mahomes not making a mistake, I just can't. I'm not gonna. It's. I'm not gonna pick against them. If Mahomes at home, I'm just not gonna pick against them.
You know, I really want to pick Jacksonville. I really do. And I was on the fence until, you know, earlier today when I found out that Trevor Lawrence seems to think that the sound, the loudness of the crowd is the same in Jacksonville as it is at Arrowhead in Kansas City. And at that point,
At that point,
you know, Samantha, like it's just that just shows a little bit. He's a little naive here, and maybe not quite ready to take down the Big Bad Chiefs. So I'm taking the Chiefs. All right. Next on the docket, the first NFC matchup. Interesting enough, three NFC East teams in the divisional round. First time that's happened since the divisions went to four. Four teams per division and four divisions each league. So that's fun. That's kind of cool, especially considering it's the NFC East, which was not too long ago was a laughing stock. Not this year. Giants are in Philly to play those Eagles. They obviously, Samantha, just met the regular season. In fact, this is like back-to-back games for the Eagles against the Giants here. One thing of note that I think makes this a little bit more interesting than maybe it would have been is the trajectory of these teams, because the Eagles didn't really play great their last 3 weeks of the season. The Giants did, and they did probably a lot of it because they had to make the playoffs, but the Giants are the hot hand right now. Are they overmatched by Philly? Absolutely. On paper, the Eagles are heads and shoulders better than the Giants, but Samantha, the Giants coming in with that hot hand, does that give you pause? Does that make you say, well, maybe this will go a little bit differently than the paper suggests?
Oh, it absolutely does. I mean, I will tell you that if this was baseball, I would be way more worried about this than I am in football. Yep. Because that's where we really say, like, oh, man, the hot hand, like, you don't want to run into that team. It's bad. But it's a little bit less, I don't know, divisive in football in that way. But it is absolutely something that gives me pause, because the gap between these teams is not that big. And as you pointed out, you know, Philly has kind of coasted at the end of the season. And a lot of that has to do with the Jalen Hurts injury and the fact that they didn't really need to be playing. And that's where I think it's tough. We don't know, you know, because as you correctly pointed out, like, the Giants had to play that way just to get into the postseason, just to survive their first playoff game. They had to. Philly didn't need to do that, and they were still the number one seed, and they were trying to protect a guy who needed some rest, who is the most important asset on their team. So, yeah, theoretically, it might mean nothing, right? It might just be, well, everybody did what they needed to do, and now we're right back where we were, which is that Philly is a far more talented football team than the Giants are at the moment. But we've seen this happen. We see it more in baseball, but we've seen it happen in football, too. So, I don't know. I think that, I mean, I'll turn this around and ask you this. Like, would you have been more confident in a Philly victory a week ago, before you saw the Giants-Vikings game, than you are now? Because that's kind of how I feel.
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good. That's what I thought, too. Yeah,
absolutely. And, well, I mean, what were we talking about last week when we were previewing that game? It's, well, the Giants kind of took their foot off the gas. That was my biggest concern. Well, clearly it didn't affect them, because they just took it to the Vikings. So, I mean, all bets are off at this point.
Yeah, I agree.
Irby, how about you? Any thoughts on that? Giants coming in with a hot hand?
It definitely is the hot hand. I'm with you guys. I did not love what they did against Philadelphia. But, you know, they 2 weeks prior to that, they did not execute their game plan, and they lose to Minnesota. They avenged that one both times in Minnesota. So here you go again. Now they get to do the same thing. Or the opportunity to do the same thing. So the good thing for the Giants, a lot of road games lately. A lot of stuff on the road. Not the first time the franchise has done that. I think we've seen that twice before.
All road games in both of those instances.
Yeah.
All road games, 2008, 2012. Yep.
It's really something I'm holding on to. Giants 6 seed. Like, that's no joke. You know, we can joke about it, but that is no joke. Something about the Giants in the 6 seed. Things happen, you know, and I don't know. I'm optimistic. The Giants, it's a similar thing as Jacksonville. There is, it's house money. Like the expectation has passed from where the Giants were. I mean, what, just roughly a year ago, a little over a year ago, They were on 4th and 8 from their own 4-yard line, and they were in the wishbone formation. Yeah, that happened. And here we are now talking about them.
Wait, was Pat Shermer there? Was Pat Shermer there?
I can't confirm that he wasn't there. You know, he might have been the one blowing the horn.
Really, he was employed by another team at the time, but you can't. I mean, can you prove he wasn't there?
Yeah, cannot prove he was not there. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I want to think that the Giants can do this. They've been close. You know, I know the first time they met it wasn't great, and who knows about the last one. But and I'm with you guys that I want to believe in what we saw last week, and that really is something that the Giants can springboard and continue to move forward. And I'm going to choose. This has been the season of I'm choosing joy. So I'm going to choose that because that was a win over a I mean, my gosh, we have pyramid schemes. We have scammers that call you for your car warranty. And then we have the Minnesota Vikings. I mean, on fraud level there. So, but that's been basically the NFC North champions for a decade now.
Yeah.
Unbelievable fraud.
So you're saying that the NFC North is the deposed king of Nigeria, right?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
I completely agree with you.
Uh-huh. Yes. Prince of Nigeria wears a Vikings jersey. Yeah. Yeah. It is. So I don't know. I want to choose joy with the Giants. I want to choose that they are using this to move forward. But Philly has proven time and time again when it's mattered that they can be a buzzsaw at times.
Uh-huh. Yeah. You know, as we get into these coaches here, Samantha, Dable versus Sirianni, I think it's worth noting, and this is something that really didn't come through at the time. Taking it back to week 18, the Giants were locked in at 6. More than likely, they were going to face, if they were to get past the Vikings, you know, again, this is week 18, we don't know this is happening yet, they were going to face the Eagles. So a lot of what happened in week 18 is probably not something we can look at because there's wrinkles that Dable's got that he did put in that week because he knew full well in 2 weeks we'd be right here playing the Giants or playing the Eagles in Philly. So makes you wonder if week 18 was incorrectly analyzed.
I chess, not checkers, right? Like, yeah. Don't show them anything. I mean, it makes you wonder, doesn't it?
It does.
Because you're right. They didn't need to win that game, and we were pretty critical about, like, oh, we think for other reasons you do need to win this game. But, I mean, I trust Brian Dable. And maybe we were right all along about that, and they were just lucky that they got the king of Nigeria in round one, and they're about to get annihilated. Like, maybe we were right, you know, or maybe it wouldn't make a lick of difference. But it does make you wonder, because, I mean, I think we can all agree that Brian Dable is probably the coach of the year. He is certainly the best hire of the last offseason. I mean, the Giants gave him a trash heap, and he turned it into a playoff team. So, I mean, imagine inheriting something from Dave Gettleman, and then it's in the second round of the playoffs. Like, I have a lot of questions about that, and whoever did that is probably coach of the year, right? So, like, good for Dable, you know? Yeah. It's incredible, and you wonder if there was some strategy to that, to, like, okay, there's a good chance we're going to see these guys again in a couple of weeks if we can get out of the first round, so let's not show them what we've got. So, very, very possible. By the same token, Nick Sirianni, another guy, you know, speaking of underestimating somebody, perhaps we underestimated the Giants. Mm-hmm. Like, Sirianni, I mean, we all laughed at this guy endlessly when he got hired. We're like, oh boy, here we go. This bozo's talking about flowers in his opening press conference. What a moron. And it turned out he was just really bad at press conferences. He's actually a really good coach. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
I mean, recall that no one believed in Jalen Hurts at first either. And we have to give Jalen Hurts some credit for that. But a lot of that credit goes to Nick Sirianni, who has quietly, and in spite of his, like, somewhat, like, doofusy press conferences, and he's gotten better, by the way, he's gotten better at that. Like, who's actually been a really good coach. So, I mean, I think this is kind of a great matchup, right? It's, like, two really, really good head coaches and two people who have been discounted at various points, whether it was just because Dable was too new and had nothing to work with, and Sirianni because he just came off like such a bozo at first. But, I mean, I have tremendous respect for both of them now. And poor Sirianni, I feel like I owe that guy so many apologies. I got a lot of mileage out of making fun of that guy on air when he first got hired. And now I feel bad about it. I'm sorry, Nick.
It's the nature of the beast. That's all. It's the nature of the beast. It is what it is.
So, anyway,
before I go to Irby, just quick shot here. Who's got the edge between these two coaches, Dable or Sirianni?
Yeah, I think if we were picking this game purely based on coaching prowess, I have to give it to Brian Dable because he does so much with so little. So, yeah, I would give him the edge in that regard. Yes.
All right, Irby, how about you? Any thoughts on the matchup here between Dable and Sirianni, and who would you give the edge to?
I just want to add, the edge, I'm the same with Dable. I like Sirianni as well. I know I've put my mouth a few times at him this season, like Samantha. I think I've, on a couple occasions, called him Sirachi instead of Siriano, but, you know, same thing. Dable, yeah, as long as he's dancing, you know, the Giants are dancing with him, and it's interesting. But, edge there, yeah, I'm Dable. I would love playing for a coach like him and what he's done and what he's had. The other one, and I'm gonna bounce it right back and vote. I'll get your opinion on this too, but it's also for Samantha. I think it also comes down to who has the better Penn State running back.
Okay, so that's, if I take that into consideration, that it actually confirms my pick for this.
Yeah.
Interesting thought. So I'm not answering that until I make my pick, and then you'll know how I feel about it.
Nice little teaser there. Well done. Well done.
You know, I'm going to go down the same path here. Anything else before we actually do that pick? Samantha, you ready to pick it?
I'm ready. I'm on a weird path backwards through, like, Penn State running backs, most of whom are horrendously bad.
Will he be at the game? Will Kajana Carter be at the game?
If he is, I'm picking whoever he's not rooting for. But, okay, all right. So, tip my hand on the question that you just asked me, and I'll tell you that I think the better Penn State running back here is Saquon Barkley. as long as he doesn't hurt himself. I do have to place that sort of qualifier on it, which is always a possibility. He's a bit fragile, but I think he's the better running back. And like, look, there's a good chance I'm going to be wrong about this game, and I feel okay about that. I want to call at least one upset, which I guess is kind of spoilering my other picks, but, you know, oh well. You guys don't care. Also, please don't ever put money on anything that I say. So it doesn't really matter. But, you know, there's going to be an upset. There is. And I think this is the best chance for it, which is not actually a knock on Philly. It's meant to be a compliment to the Giants. And like we say, third meetings are weird, right? Like, we always talk about this.
Yeah.
Third meeting is weird. Mm-hmm. And I'm a little bit worried about Jalen Hurts being a bit rusty. I think if it comes down to coaching, the Giants have the edge, or because introduced the Penn State running back question, which I would also give the Giants the edge. None of this adds up to being the better football team. The better football team is Philly. But, you know, weird things happen, man. Weird things. And a great way to make weird things happen, so shall we come back to Titanic again? A real man makes his own luck? Like, Brian Dable, man. I'm putting all of my faith in Brian Dable, the bridge troll, to pull this one off.
Irby, how about you? Giants or Eagles?
Dang, I got to follow that up. Mine is not going to be as well thought out. That was well done. I'm sticking with the home team here.
I've been thinking about this a lot.
Yeah, no, that was good. And throwing the Penn State in, it was a nice little, well done. Well done. Way to handle that curveball. I'm going to stick with the home team here, Philly. I just think there's enough firepower. I just think there's, especially on the offensive side. We talked about, look, Daniel Jones, don't make the mistakes. Saquon Barkley's the better running back. You know, the receiving, you know, has looked better for the Giants, and that's great, and that's been wonderful, and that's one side of the ball. But I keep going back to the defensive issues and the firepower that Philly has. So I'm going to take Philadelphia to pull this one.
I'm taking the Giants.
Yeah.
I'm taking the Giants. And I'm
yes.
Gonna, I'm going to tell you guys why. With me. I'm going to tell you guys why. This is going to be classic NFC East. Now, there's a lot of nuance in this division. Besides, you know, it's a lot more than just that these teams hate each other. But the Giants have sat here and they've listened all season long to how awesome the Eagles are. They've listened to that all year long. They got swept by the Cowboys. They got swept by the Eagles. They're going to come in with a chip on their shoulder the size of Montana.
Yeah, that's a great point.
And yep. That's what's going to be the difference. The envy, the jealousy of all the talk has been building up with this Giants team over 19 weeks of football. That's about to come out. And there's no football basis for it. This is just NFC East football. And the Giants are going to win this game.
That's a terrific point. And also, I mean, I'll double down on that and say, you know, half a season ago, it was like, well, they're not going to pay Daniel Jones, right? Why would you pay Daniel Jones? Like, Now you have to pay Daniel Jones, right? You have to. Like, don't you think some of his performance is related to that? Like, oh, you don't think I should get paid? Let me show you why I should get paid. And I don't think he's done yet.
Yeah. I agree. All right. Let's move over to the Sunday games. AFC first. Bengals, Bills, and Buffalo. Samantha, I think we got to start with the Bills and how sloppy this team has played for some time now. Really looked just... If they're playing anybody but the Dolphins last week, they lose. And while no one really thought they were going to lose that game, even as that game was ongoing, no one thought they were going to lose. They could have lost that game. And there's no reason
to lose. Way to beat the Chargers.
That's fair.
That's a valid point, yeah.
Yes. That's fair. But still, I mean...
Otherwise...
How? Yes. I mean, is this a legitimate concern, or is this just... getting ready for the real part of the playoffs, if you're the Bills. Like how big of a problem is their sloppy play?
Okay, look, if the only time we'd seen this happen with the Bills was last week against Miami, I would say I'm not worried about this at all. You were off for a game. You were overconfident. Like, I will echo what you said and say that at no point, regardless of the fact that it was close and that the Bills were sloppy, it never felt like Miami was going to win that game, you know, even though... You know, Mike McDaniel's over there, you know, sucking on his vape pen and, like, butchering the clock. Like, had he not done that, that didn't even mean the Dolphins were going to win that game, right? So,
right.
If last week was the only time that it happened, I would have just said, yeah, everybody's off sometimes. They got overconfident. They've probably learned the lesson. But the thing is we've seen the Bills do this a lot. They are a sloppy football team, and I love them, and I want them to win the Super Bowl more than anything. But you guys... they are not exactly precise. We've seen them be incredibly flawless at times. We have also seen them look like garbage against teams that it should be easy for them to look, at the very least, extremely competent. So I think they got a good lesson a week ago that had to have scared the crap out of them, or at least I hope it did. You know, Josh Allen acknowledged it. He always does. He's great about that. You know, he's always willing to own it and say, hey, I was bad. You know, we were lucky to get out of that alive. So they're certainly aware of it. But it is something that they slip into pretty frequently. And the Bengals, who have their own problems, a little bit different, but they've got some issues too. And the Bills are the better football team. But if you play a game like the one you played a week ago, you're not going to beat the Bengals.
No. No. No, you're not. Irby, anything you want to add to that?
Some very fair points about this Buffalo team. It is the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde of the NFL this season. And the weird thing is we've seen this before with teams where it's like, oh, yeah, well, they play up to their opponents and they play down to their crappy opponents, but it's not even that. Like, it's borderline random, just absolutely random of what they do. And I hope, and Alan, like you said, Alan talking about it and addressing it, being at home, you know, a combination of those two things, I feel like that's going to be enough for Buffalo to realize that, we nearly screwed the pooch last week, and we survived against a Miami team that had beat them, and all three of their matchups were decided by 3 points or less, so that was always going to be difficult. It was always going to be a tough matchup. And they've done fine at home this season. One blip on the mark, but that's it. So now it's Cincinnati. Yeah, this is... And we saw that, too, even in the game a few weeks ago that was inevitably canceled. It was not a great start for Buffalo. Maybe 10 minutes into the game, a lot can change there. But Buffalo, yeah, up and down, up and down. And this is why this team is so frustrating. When they're up, they are a Super Bowl contender for each of the last 3 years. You're so up and down, that's the last thing you need in the playoffs. Where a Cincinnati team that did it last year, and I don't know, are they poised to do a similar run where they're just on even keel, and an even keel with a slight increase week after week after week?
All right, Samantha, let's talk about those Bengals real quick. The one thing that we haven't talked about when the Bengals have come up this year is they don't seem to change much between the first half and the second. Are they just not making adjustments at halftime offensively? I guess let's just hone in on that. It seems like they roll with their game plan no matter what happens in the first half.
Oh, they absolutely do. I mean, there's been some interesting discussions, and we haven't talked about this on this show, so I'm glad you brought this up, about sort of various teams and what their identity is. And we have these teams that just adjust, no matter what you're doing, the sort of Belichick inability to constantly reinvent. The Giants are the first team that comes to mind there, right? Brian Daboll's really, mm-hmm. really good at this. He just keeps adapting. I mean, from just drive to drive, from play to play, really good at it. And we also have some teams that just never adjust. They just play their game, and there is nothing that's going to move them off that spot. Exhibit A, the Vikings. They don't ever adjust to anything. They do what they do. And Baltimore is like this, too. Cincinnati is a weird case because defensively, they do adjust. They adjust not just at the half, but from drive to drive. But offensively, they never change a thing. They just do what they do. And it's a problem, potentially. Especially when you kind of put it together with, like, look, I think Joe Burrow is wonderful and he's an incredible talent, but he has a real weak point, which is that he is not great at adapting post-snap. So when you put that together with the fact that the whole offense just is very, very one note, then if I'm the opposing defense coming into a game like this, I think, all I got to do is knock them off their spot, right? Make them uncomfortable.
Yeah.
They're just going to keep grinding. And that doesn't work in the NFL. You can get away with it if you're able to just kind of have your way with the opposing defense, with what you do, whatever that might be, even if you're not willing to adapt. The Bills, and certainly, like, I'm going to give Mike a high deck. That's huge in this game. That is hugely important here. Like, I think that's going to make a big difference in terms of injury, but they are still a pretty beat-up defense. But they're smart, and they're willing to make the adjustments from game to game, and I think that's going to be a problem for Cincinnati, because I don't think the Bengals are suddenly going to wake up and decide that they're going to start making offensive adjustments. We just haven't seen that out of them. They either get it done with what they do, or they fail.
Irby, how about you? Thoughts on the Bengals and their lack of adjustments at halftime?
Yeah, I guess it doesn't really matter whether it's going to work or not. It's what they're going to do. They're going to continue to do the same thing over and over again. I feel like that can always be an issue and be the difference in winning and losing playoff games, but this is a team that made the Super Bowl last year. Here we go again. I mean, you took care of business against Baltimore. It wasn't that impressive, but it's a win, and that's what we've learned out of anything. Stop looking at scores when it comes to the postseasons, and just survive in advance. Yeah, this is a Cincinnati team who, I mean, we talk about 0-2, 2-3, 4-4, and now they still have those same four losses. It's they put it together at the right time, and this is what happened last year. They weren't that impressive throughout the season, and they put it together in November and December and January. Mm-hmm. Here we go again, putting it together in November and December and January, because this team, I mean, said that on there, we've talked about these long winning streaks that we've seen from multiple teams. Cincinnati's another one of them. They have not lost a game since Halloween.
You know, it is amazing the difference the year makes. This time last year, we kept, okay, well, this is where the Bengals turn into a pumpkin, or this is where the Bengals turn into a pumpkin, and they make it all the way to the Super Bowl. So, what a difference the year makes. Samantha, who do you have here? Bengals or Bills?
The Bills. Look, and also for what it's worth, I'm seeing that Micah Hyde is not playing, so make of that what you will, whether that makes a difference to how you pick this game or not. But for me, I think the Bills are going to buckle down, at least for the week. I don't know. I'm a little bit nervous about whether they can maintain a lack of sloppiness, shall we say, for three more games to get all the way to a Super Bowl and then win it. But I do think they got the daylight scared out of them a week ago by Miami, and I think that's going to make them snap to a little bit. And they are a better team than the Bengals, and they're a smarter team than the Bengals. And I think that's going to be the difference. I think Buffalo gets the win here.
Irby, how about you? Who do you have here? Bengals or Bills?
I'm the same. I'm taking Buffalo here. I like this Cincinnati team. I like the run that they are on. And they obviously, it's a been here, done this before. I'm trusting Josh Allen. I know that's it's kind of been a 5-2 ratio on his touchdowns to interceptions this year. And he's made some bad, bad, bad mistakes throughout the year. But he also knows how to get it done. And you're at home, and it's home crowd, the Bills Mafia. We haven't talked a lot about the Bills Mafia this year. We're going to get to see plenty of it Sunday afternoon, because, well, I mean, that kickoff time, you know they're going to be up there bright and early. And, I don't know, Allen, Diggs, Burrow, Chase, I mean, it sounds almost even, but I'm going to take Allen, Diggs as just a little bit more, because this is one that you wouldn't be able to give me a score. I have no idea a score. I'm just going to say it's a one possession, and it may very, very, very well come down to who has the ball last.
I actually think it will come down to who has the ball last. I'm also taking the Bills, my preseason Super Bowl favorite. I'm not going to abandon them just yet, but let's see how they play on Sunday. All right, one more to go before we get into that time capsule. Cowboys in Santa Clara, San Francisco, California. What is with these California teams, man? The 49ers are hosting the Cowboys. So, really, I think before we get into the game here, are you starting to feel, maybe, actually, this is a better question for Irby. Let's start off with you, Irby, because are you beginning to feel a little bit of a rekindling of the Cowboys 49ers rivalry? Because it was a year ago that the 49ers knocked the Cowboys out. And it really didn't feel like that the same rivalry game that we had seen when we were kids, or that even, you know, fans saw when we were right before we were born back in the early 80s. I mean, this was a huge rivalry for so long, but lately I haven't felt it, and really until now. And it's all because the 49ers are the ones that knocked the Cowboys out last year. Is that starting to spice things up again between these two?
Yes, the fires, I think, are rekindling a little bit of what we saw in the early 90s and throughout the 80s as well, because And what does it with this rivalry, and I hate that I'm putting it out there in the universe, but I'm going to have to do it. What does it with this rivalry is it's the road team. You know, last year it was supposed to be Dallas taking care of business at home, and here's a Niners team that's been there before, and it's kind of inconsistent, and San Francisco took care of business and enforced their will and won the game, and Mike McCarthy lost track of time at the very end.
Yeah.
Here we go again, where it's the exact opposite. Like, this is a Niners team that's on an incredible run right now, and beat the dead horse. Ever since they got Christian McCaffrey, yeah, it's not a coincidence. Okay, stop. yeah, this Niners team is on a roll offensively, defensively. Just everything is clicking well. We're the rookie quarterback, and here's a Dallas team that's coming in and it's kind of being treated as though, well, yeah, they're not going to take, they can't beat this Niners team. Well, we've talked about this in this rivalry many times, and it's been a while, as you've pointed out, though. It has been quite a while since we've got to talk about it, but here we are again where, yes, Dallas has the weapons to do this and to go into San Francisco or Santa Clara or San Jose or wherever and win this thing. Absolutely. And that's what's building this rivalry. And that, I think, was a huge part of this rivalry, is it always felt like, and it wasn't always, but a lot of times it felt like it was the road team going into the other one's house and beating them up at their own home.
Yeah, Samantha, this is the first time since the 92, 93, 94 stretch where these two teams are facing each other in the playoffs back-to-back years. What about from your vantage point? Is this rivalry starting to kick up a little bit?
Well, I think it's going to be interesting to see if this sort of reignites the concept of NFL rivalries in general, because I guess my whole take on this, I've been thinking a lot about this over the last season or so, and it's something that I've thought about for years, actually, is that, like, I think rivalry is mostly dead in the NFL. Mm-hmm. Pre-agency really did a number on it, and it's gotten worse and worse, especially as we see more people willing to change teams. We're seeing a shift more towards the NBA style, where guys go where they think they can win, and that always dilutes rivalries. And also, I think that there is a misconception among fans that players feel the way that they do. I mean, I can't even tell you the ledge you have to walk people back off of in Cleveland about the Steelers. And it's like, first of all, Pittsburgh doesn't really consider Cleveland its rival anymore. They think Baltimore is their rival. But Browns people are still clinging to that old Steelers rivalry from like 40 years ago. And it's not very real for the players. Like, yeah, sometimes you get some chirping. You get a little more chirping than you get if you were playing, I don't know, the Chargers. But for the most part, like, I think NFL rivalries are overblown. And I think it's mostly because the divisions, and this is a good thing for the NFL, there's been so much parity that when you put that together with all the other stuff I just mentioned, that we no longer get situations where it's just the same two teams duking it out over and over. So there is no Yankees Red Sox in the NFL, because we don't have two teams in the same division who are consistently that good for 15 years in a row. It just doesn't happen,
right?
Which is great for the competitive balance of the league. Maybe not so great for that feeling of like, wow, I hate these guys. It's going to feel extra good to beat them and extra bad to lose to them. But where I think that the true rivalries, the ones that can survive or that are easy to reignite, are less about who's the guy in your division who you hated 40 years ago, and now you just hate them because you've always hated them. The rivalries that are going to matter are, you know, Kansas City, Buffalo, and teams that repeatedly meet year after year after year in the postseason. That's what's going to make a difference. And this is an interesting one because this is kind of a rivalry from when we were kids. And theoretically, you would think, okay, well, that's dead. That's forever ago. That's exactly what I was just talking about. Except that you just need that one little spark, right, to reignite it. It's a lot different than creating a rivalry that never existed before, trying to manufacture one with, I don't know, the other team in the same state or somebody in your division you don't really care about because they've stunk for 20 years. Like, I think it's going to be really easy to get back to this place with these two teams because they hated each other, and you guys are, like, the perfect people to be talking to about this. I didn't have a dog in the fight. But, man, as somebody who had no preference in that battle and basically just rooted for whichever one Deion Sanders was on at the time. I loved watching those because everybody was so fired up. They hated each other. The teams hated each other. The cities hated each other. The fan bases hated each other. It was great. Like, there was so much animosity. It was so much fun. And even if you weren't part of it, you still kind of felt like you were part of something. And I think that this is the kind of rivalry that can be reignited. If we get a good game here, well, maybe these teams going away anytime soon, right? So,
yeah,
I don't know.
I think that's a big piece of this, Samantha. Is it's got the ingredients because they probably are going to face each other. And I think, Irby, for me, like the fact that this rivalry goes back generations, like this goes back to the 70s, early 80s. and then it was rekindled in the 90s. Now here we are 30 years later talking about it again, where we're the, you know, the older part of the generation from the past and watch these two teams go at it. That for me is why this could potentially get kicked back up, because it's me talking to my dad about the 49ers, and you could feel the hatred he's got going all the way back to 1980 and the catch. That's where it started for him. You know, for us, it was 92, 93, 94. I remember, in fact, like, you know, we talk about rage rooting, Samantha, a lot. Rage rooting against the 49ers was my first ever just actively hating a team so much I wanted them to lose. I didn't want to play them. I didn't want to see them in 1995. And, of course, the Packers ended up beating them in the divisional, and the Cowboys beat the Packers to go to their last Super Bowl, the last time they were there. But that's what this means, Irby. That's what I think where we're at with Cowboys 49ers. And as Samantha said perfectly, like all those little things that would make a rivalry happen again, they're right there. It really just needs that spark. I wonder if we're going to get that spark this week.
Right. We need a Theo run out there and just have both teams light him up at the 50-yard line.
Well, I mean, Theo did want to try. He did try to play for the Cowboys again at age 50. So there's that.
Yeah, that's true. That is very true. This one, the rage rooting, I like that. Because I was the same. Like, I remember in middle school in the 90s there when going to class and when these playoff games would come up and they would tell school, hey, everybody can wear their Cowboy shirts on Friday. And I showed up in my Niners jersey. And the first time I got in trouble for it, it's like, why? It's like, well, this was, you're not supposed to. I was like, no, I'm actually a fan of this team. I don't care about your blue. I don't care about your silver. Like, I'm not trying to be a jerk and just be a rebel. It's like, I actually care about this team. And I'm not going to wear your stuff or wear my uniform. So it was that. It was, you know, my mom would tell the stories of my dad and I couldn't. We had to watch these games in separate rooms because, and that was her call. Like, it was, no, y'all aren't watching this in the same room because neither of us are much of the, we're not the celebrate, cheer in your face type. We're just the kind of, that moment, like as soon as your team scores, go boom. Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm going to say. Just boom. Mm-hmm. You're watching. Yeah. So
here's the slogan for the rivalry, tearing families apart since 1993 or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I think you had to go, well, back, no, to let's 1980.
Go. Yeah, dude, 1981. Yeah, yeah.
49ers tearing families apart since 1981. There you go.
Yes.
Beautiful.
I would put that bumper sticker on my car. I would put that bumper sticker on my car. Yes. And
100%. Buy the shirt.
And it's wonderful because it's fun too. Like, my in-law, my brother-in-law and father-in-law are big Cowboy fans, and it sounds like they're going to be coming into town to watch it. And they weren't sure. It's like, are you cool watching? Like, yeah, none of us are jerks. If we're going to cheer for our teams, we're not going to be cheering each other's faces. And so, yeah, y'all come watch it. It's fun. And I do it with my next-door neighbor. She's a diehard Cowboys fan, and I joke with her daughter. I was like, hey, your mom and I are on good terms right now, but it is only Monday, so we'll see if we can last being on good terms as the week gets longer and longer and longer. So I don't know. Yeah, this feels, I hope it feels like we can get there again. And last year was one example of, and here we go again. You've got your two, and you're right. It's that spark. It's something, we need something to happen here. And last year wasn't, because it's funny. Some would say, well, last year, cause it was so close. It's like, well, last year ended because of a bonehead play. Like, it wasn't as much of a spark. Like, you need a catch. You need a, you know, you said it first, so I just, and here's the rage fun that I'm having. I'm just going to say that right there, knowing that your dad's going to listen to this. The catch. I'm gonna say it a little more time, right? I'm quiet. The catch. So there you go. There you go. That's all the spark you need, right?
I'd rather not have that spark this week. But no, there's kindling all over that field. It just needs that spark. One little spark, and this rivalry can get back to being as heated as it was 30 years ago. All right, let's pick this one. Samantha, who do you have here, Cowboys or 49ers?
See, now after he said that, it made me want to pick the Cowboys, like, for your dad. I want to do that for your dad. I don't think I can do it because I don't think the Cowboys can beat the 49ers. Now, I think the Cowboys proved a lot a week ago. We said we were going to talk a little more about this. So I was very skeptical of Dallas. And after what they did to Tampa Bay, and more, maybe more importantly, what they did to Tom Brady a week ago, you know, who was kind of their playoff bugaboo, I thought, all right, Dallas, you know what? You've earned my respect. Like, I'm going to take you much more seriously than I was. And yet, at the end of the day, we come to Mike McCarthy. I cannot do it, guys. I can't. I can't. Now, there's a scenario for Dallas here where Dallas just jumps all over San Francisco and they can't catch up. Absolutely. Like, there's a scenario where Dan Quinn puts together a beautiful defensive game that shuts down the 49ers offense. But there are so many more scenarios where Mike McCarthy just, like, does some stuff that doesn't work out too good for Dallas. And then here we are in the exact same place that we've always been in with him. So I just don't trust him. Like, and I think that is more pervasive for me than anything else here. I also think the 49ers are, you know, when we talked about them, we talked about how they were kind of uniquely designed to take down Philly. And I think that is less true of Dallas, but I still think they're probably the better team. Brock Purdy has kind of, I think, earned his stripes in terms of, like, hey, you know, this kid's not just going to come apart in the postseason. So I think they're the more talented roster. They're certainly the smarter team because Mike McCarthy. You know, anyone could beat Molly. We'll do it again. Except the Chargers. We'll do that again. Except the Chargers. But, yeah, I can't do it. I'm super excited about this game. I hope it fires up a huge rivalry and we can start that all over again. But at the end of the day, the 49ers are a better football team, and I fully expect them to pull this off.
Ooh. Okay, Irby. The time has come. We both have skin in this game, so it's our turn. Who do you at?
You set that up like I'm about to pick Dallas and you're about to pick San Francisco.
I did not.
That's great. That's just, like, we already have the tiebreaker here.
I set that up in exactly the way that it's going to come out. Trust me.
Yeah, no. I know what you're doing. I've been around it. Yeah. Last week, what Dallas did not shock me to Tampa Bay. Tampa Bay was not a playoff team. They were not worthy, but much more fun to see Detroit in that game. But that's the rules that we have, and we've got to fix them. And sure as hell shouldn't have been in Tampa. It should at least been in Dallas. But whatever. Dallas did what they were supposed to do. You know, I know I texted you when it was 18-0 and saying this game is over. And yeah. You're, as a true fan, you're like, yeah, we'll see. And I'm like, no. And I would say the exact same thing in your shoes, but it's the when you don't have a skin in the game and you look at it and realize, no, this Tampa Bay team literally cannot score 18 points. Like, it's mathematically over at that point. But Dallas, give them credit, went in and did what they were supposed to do. And Dallas has not done that multiple times throughout the year, going in what they're supposed to do. And here we go again. They have an opportunity where Dallas has the weapons. They have the playmakers on defense, and they have the weapons on offense to win this game in Santa Clara. They won't do that, however, on Sunday. It will be San Francisco and a team who's running on quarterback number 3 and arguably is the best of the 3 quarterbacks and is running on how many different running backs? I mean, my gosh, their leading rusher through 7 weeks of the season finished off in Miami because you went and got Christian McCaffrey for a bunch of draft picks. And it doesn't matter because that's what you wanted. That's the piece that you needed. That's what Kyle and this coaching staff needed to put this formula together. And with Garoppolo leading, we thought that was the formula. And boom, here we go. They've got something special, and here we go. I'm beyond dumbfounded that it was Brock Purdy that was the missing piece along with McCaffrey. But it's working. It's absolutely working. With Purdy and McCaffrey and Mitchell and Kittle and Samuel and Ayuk, and it's just San Francisco is doing something right now. They have the opportunity in hand that they have gotten healthy at the right time. They have gotten their pieces together at the right time, and good offensive teams that have really good defenses, when they get healthy at the right time, can make some serious noise. But you got to execute. And I think San Francisco's got enough to execute and get the job done this Sunday.
Big shocker. You took the 49ers, Samantha. Are you shocked? I'm shocked.
I am. You could knock me over with a feather.
No, all outstanding points, Irby. All outstanding points. I will say this. Dallas has obviously been inconsistent, and that's being nice. But when they're on, and that defense is swarming the way they swarmed last week or the way they swarmed in Minnesota midseason, when they're on and they're playing at the level that they actually can play at, they're very difficult to beat. Now, is the sledding up the hill more steep for the Cowboys than it is the 49ers in terms of winning this game? Yes, absolutely. There are nightmare matchups all along that defense. What do you do about Kittle? What do you do about McCaffrey? There are problems that Dan Quinn is going to have to out-scheme to win. But he's done it before this year. And he's done it as his defense, as his secondary has been dropping like flies. It's been next man up, and Dan Quinn can still find a way to put that out there. Smith, I think you said it perfectly. It doesn't necessarily have to be that Michael McCarthy loses the game. It's that Dan Quinn wins it for him with his defensive scheming.
Yep. Yep.
Okay. So I'm gonna put a lot in the bank here. I'm going to make some assumptions. I'm going to assume that it's not Mr. Fluffy that the Cowboys put out there this week, that it's actually what they did in Minnesota. That's what they did last week defensively. I'm also going to bank that Dak Prescott is going to have a similar game to what he had last week. And that's how Dallas wins the game, and that's the only way they win this game, is if Dak Prescott is playing at a high level and that defense swarms the football like they did last week. I'm banking that they are, and I'm banking, and that's what's going to put Dallas over the top on Sunday. So I'm going to pick the Cowboys.
Okay, you too. I want to ask you guys one more thing about this rivalry thing before we move on to the time capsule, because I think this is important, because I want to know where you guys are at with this rivalry. How important is this to you? So would you, Bo, marry a 49ers fan? Would you, Irby, marry a Cowboys fan? And I'm asking this because I think that there's a line here between I don't like this team and I hate this team and they're my rival, because I will use myself as an example. I grew up a Browns fan. I married a Steelers fan. I lost zero sleep over this. This has had no impact on my life. I never thought about it. Didn't matter. But I can tell you this. You would have to drag my dead corpse to the altar to get me to marry a Twins fan. It would never happen. See, so I want to know, how dedicated are the two of you to this rivalry? Like, assume there's nothing else wrong with her, but she's a 49ers fan or she's a Cowboys fan. Can you still marry her?
I love that. I love that. Let me tell you something, because I think I'm very similar to you in this regard. I could marry a 49ers fan. Ain't nowhere in hell I'm marrying an Astros fan. Ain't happening.
Okay, but like, to be fair, no one's marrying an Astros
okay,
fan,
fine.
Right? They all have to marry each other. Also, nobody is marrying an Astros fan. Would you marry a Mariners fan?
No. I wouldn't marry a Mariners fan.
There,
I would,
there we
yeah.
go. Okay.
No.
All right.
But I would marry a 49ers fan.
Okay, so maybe all this says is that we all care a lot more about baseball, like emotionally, than we do about football. But it does answer my question to an extent about the rivalry. But Irby, what about you? You marry a Cowboys fan? I know you have a child that's trying to become a Cowboys fan.
Right. Well, yeah, that's where
the problem.
I have to set this line, you know, very, very, very smartly, because my wife would probably consider herself a Cowboys fan. She's not a big football fan, but she is the keep the peace, and she grew up in a Cowboy household, so she would do that. But I think that's and because of that, I am going to put it on her, especially if her dad and brother come over here. I might put her on the spot right before kickoff and go, "Hey, Amy, what are you cheering for?" We'll see what she does, but yes.
Irby, do you just have like this really glorious doghouse that I don't know about? Because I would love to get my hands on one of those.
If he is sleeping in the yard on Sunday night, we'll know.
You know what? If I'm sleeping in the yard Sunday night, knowing that we're playing another football game a week later, I'm sleeping just fine.
You know, there's something, there's some honor in that.
We will do wild things for sports teams. I mean, like, as somebody whose father made her eat their cereal with their face when they were, like, six, like a dog, you know, because of the dog pound, Yeah.
There you go. But to answer your other point, So yes, technically I married a Cowboys fan, but I would never marry a St. Louis Cardinals.
Okay. Ooh, yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Me too.
I would say I would never marry a Marlins fan, but I don't think there are any. So, do we have those diehard Marlins fans?
There's some. There really are.
No, Marlins man doesn't count because who would marry that guy, regardless?
Oh God, Marlins man. Okay.
All right. So I think we've just established that we all care a lot more about baseball than football. But okay, it was an interesting thought experiment. Okay.
All right. One last piece of business before we call it a week. Let's jump into that time capsule. Irby, what do you have for us, bud?
Well, you know, what's beautiful about this, and you two probably can have guessed this happening, let's continue where we've been. Yesterday, January 17th, was the 30th anniversary of the rekindling of that Dallas-San Francisco. That Dallas-San Francisco, a game at Candlestick Park. And if you remember, that was the sod, or maybe we call it lack of sod issues, where it rained all week, and it was raining right before the game and some during, and they had to bring in sod, and it didn't take very well, so that the grass was literally just coming up in chunks. And the Cowboys wore that what did you call it? Like, it was like that alternate white uniform. And I remember Troy Aikman just having chunks of green and brown all over him. I think Emmitt Smith's jersey was brown by the end of it. Like, he looked more like a 49er player. But, that was 30 years ago yesterday that this started. And it goes to the conversation that we had where it was, this is year two, and if it's continuing. So, all that fun said, 30 years ago, 1993. So, that's the first one. So let's get your minds wrapped up about some of the fun things that happened in 1993. Pretty easy here. I'm talking about this stuff. Bo, you can probably fill us in pretty quickly on the Super Bowl in 1993.
Oh, yeah.
Second most points ever. Is that right? Yeah, second most points. I can't remember. Who has the most points ever? No, did I lose you? Did I lose you?
In the Super Bowl? I don't know the answer to that.
I think it's the 49ers.
It is the 49ers of 55 to your 52.
Yeah, that was the
you one. You should have had 59, but Don Beebe had something to say about that.
Oh, that was so beautiful. Oh, can we just take a moment to appreciate Don Beebe stripping the ball from Leon Lett?
Cowboys won the game. I don't care.
There you go. Good answer.
Flags fly forever, right?
Yes, there you go.
Flags fly forever. It also gives me the opportunity to make fun of Leon Lett without feeling really awful about bringing up a bad memory.
Yeah. Good point. That was the world of the NFL. In Major League Baseball, in 1993, we gained two teams. The Rockies, and a few minutes ago mentioned the Marlins, at that time Florida, not Miami, although they never moved. World Series, you guys remember that one?
It was the Blue Jays.
That would be the Toronto Blue Jays over the Philadelphia Phillies.
There it is. I thought it was the Phillies.
Mitch Williams pitched like your hair's on fire. Did you say to them?
Joe Carter, game six. So there we go. Keep going. NBA. You guys got anything on that one?
That was Rockets over Magic, wasn't it? No.
No, it's the Bulls.
It is the Bulls. Yeah, Rockets over Magic was 95. That's the Bulls over... Ooh.
I'm going to mix it up with the year before, but I think this is the Suns, is it not?
That is correct. This was the third in that three-peat. Because later on that year, October 6th, 1993, Michael Jordan... quote unquote retired. It would be a Brett Favre type retirement. White Sox, yes.
Chicago White Sox interlude.
Yeah. So Jordan retired only to 2 years later, show back up. 17 months later, show back up, take care of business. So NHL, y'all got anything on that one?
Was that the Rangers year 93?
No, not quite there. This is actually a big deal in the NHL, what happened this year.
Ooh. 93. Okay, hang on.
93. I don't.
It wasn't the Kings, was it?
It's like, I mean, I want to say it's the Penguins because I'm just guessing based on the era, but I'm pretty sure that's wrong.
No, but Bo, in there, you did guess the loser.
Was this
the Kings?
Okay.
Hang on. Was this the other guy, Gretzky? No.
Yeah, he would have been. Yeah. He was on that team. Yeah, I don't know if that's the year they acquired him.
They got him though. Okay,
but they lost, right? So
they lost.
Not the Penguins. So the Penguins are the year before, right?
Correct.
They're in there somewhere.
Okay. Yes, 92 Penguins.
I don't think I know the answer to this.
Kings lose too. Let's say, well, okay. I
don't know anything about hockey?
So many would say not a big. I think it's a big deal. I would say an entire country north of us really doesn't like this being a big deal.
Oh,
because it was.
Oh, well, that narrows it down.
It was the last time a Canadian team won. Okay, it's okay. Not. It's not Edmonton. Is it Montreal?
Toronto or Montreal?
Was it the Maple Leafs? Was it Montreal?
I think it has to be, doesn't it?
Yes, that is correct. It was Montreal. Montreal Canadiens, the last Canadian team. Although they made the cup last year, didn't work out so great.
Hurt years ago.
Also, that year in 93, we were introduced to the Florida Panthers. There you go, state of Florida, getting another team. Oh, and sorry, kids out there, but this is the actual name at the time, the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Yes, that officially was their name when they first started. Yuck.
Now they're just the Ducks.
Yeah. Now it's just the Ducks. So that one other good little nugget of sporting world history before we jump into movies and music. In November 12, 1993, was the first ever UFC fight. UFC 1. And how barbaric was it? It was an 8-man tournament that took place in one evening. That's right. You would fight, and then a few minutes later, fight again, and then again. And Brazilian jiu-jitsu master Royce Gracie ended up submitting 3 people to win UFC 1. Now the weird one. Any clue where the first ever UFC fight in the United States took place?
Vegas?
That would have been my guess.
Too easy. Too easy. No. Think about this. Not a big deal. Not.
Wait to hear what you were saying about that, because I was like, which one's UFC? Is it the fake one or the real one?
The real, yeah. Montana? No. See, you're getting a little bit closer there of North where, the very first UFC fight took place in Denver, Colorado.
Wow.
Seems weird. Yeah. Okay.
Does seem very weird. So, being a nice guy with my TFL team playing, I'll let you guys, you want to do movies or music first? What you feeling?
I mean, I don't think it matters, but I tell you what, let's start with music. Let's have some
fun. Music?
Yeah, we usually do movies first. So, yeah.
Boom. All right. Music. So fun little nugget that may or may not help you. 4 of the top 10, and it ends up actually being 4 of the top 7 songs has the word love in the title.
I know one. Because this is the Bodyguard, right?
Yeah. So, yeah, I'll always love you.
So I will always love you.
Yeah.
That is number 1. Whitney Houston's I Will Always Love You.
Didn't she also do the national anthem? She did the national anthem for the Super Bowl one of those years, early 90s.
That was 91.
Is it 91?
91, I think. The greatest national anthem of all time.
It was the greatest national anthem.
Yeah, I think that was 91, but might be 92.
I Always Love You definitely was number 1. That was a big deal.
Yeah. So okay, I'm trying to think about other songs that have love in the title that would have.
This would be that Big Boys to Men era, right?
Yeah, I would think they would be in there.
They're somewhere.
So if this is early, like Boys to Men gets up at number 12, is the highest they get in the Still of the Night. But you're getting...
So we're a little bit after the big Boys to Men push then. Okay, so what about... Okay, I think I know one of them's got to be... Oh, what is that band called? SWV? Beak? That's definitely got to be on there. That was a huge song that year. Is that on there?
SWV. Number 6! Well done!
Woo!
Well okay. done.
But now I'm trying to think of songs that say love in the title. That would be
so am I.
This time.
Hang on.
The Elvis remake. UB40. Can't Help Falling in Love.
There you go. Number three. Can't Help Falling in Love by the English reggae and pop band UB40. So number three. Well done.
I saw them in concert once.
93. It wasn't 93 when we're getting into movies in a second. But wasn't that when they did Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves with Kevin Costner and Morgan Freeman?
No, that's earlier.
That's 92?
That's earlier, yeah.
I think that's even 94.
It may have technically been 91, but I know what year I was in school. It was earlier that I was younger.
I was thinking about that.
Yeah, you're thinking of Everything I Do It For You.
Yeah, yeah. I was thinking about that Bryan Adams song.
That's before this.
No Bryan Adams in this.
Okay. You're right, that was 91. I don't know what I'm thinking.
Is there a Mariah Carey song? I feel like there has to be.
There is a Mariah Carey song. And here's the thing. Technically, so the word love is in here four times. The letters L-O-V-E are in here five because of this Mariah Carey song, which the word is in there. But
Dream Lover.
There you go, Dream Lover. I didn't feel like I needed to say that it's in five because that's technically not.
No,
like, we're just going straight for the word love. So, yes, that was Mariah Carey was number eight, Dream Lover.
What about Madonna?
So, No Madonna. Madonna must not have released something. I don't see her anywhere near the top.
What about Snoop Dogg?
Here.
How about Snoop Dogg?
Yeah.
Ooh. A little early for Snoop Dogg, yeah?
Little early for all of that. Even Dr. Dre, just outside the top 10 with Nothing But a G-Thing.
I love that song.
Which was probably big a year before that. That's probably
there you go. Around.
I think it's a little late for
that. I love that song. That was a good song.
I do too. Excellent song.
To help y'all along with the top four, so we've got an American pop icon. We've also got a duo who recently showed up in a commercial.
Oh, Marky Mark.
No?
Commercial. The ice cream commercial.
There you go.
There it is. I have no idea.
Whoop, there it is by Tag Team was number two.
Okay. Those guys had a name, huh? Okay. Yeah. That is a terrible song.
They say it in the song, Tag Team Back Again.
I have no idea why.
That's the first line.
I have no idea why I blurred out Marky Mark. I was thinking of Milli Vanilli.
Well, no.
They're before this. And so is Marky Mark. Good Vibrations would be before this. So would Milli Vanilli.
Isn't picking Milli Vanilli basically like trying to guess a hole-in-one? Like, you've got one shot here. Literally, one shot. So
yeah, but I thought I saw him in a commercial recently. That's why I blurred out Marky Mark when I met Milli Vanilli. This is how I play this game, guys. It's scattershot.
Yeah.
I'm glad I don't get buzzed for wrong answers. I don't get buzzed.
No, you don't. No. All right, so y'all doing good. 1, 2, 3. We got down. We got six. We've got eight. Four, pop icon. Not Michael Jackson.
Janet Jackson.
Yeah, but what song?
What song would Janet Jackson have in 1993?
Is this All Right? No, that's wrong. I don't know. I'm not a big Janet Jackson fan, and I was not a Janet Jackson fan at the time either, so I'm sure I know what it is, but...
The word love is in there.
Okay, maybe I can get this. All right, Janet Jackson's song with the word love. When I think of you, that's way over.
I'm blanking on this, too.
Let me talk through this. All right. What's the name of that song? I can't remember the name of the song. I can sing it in my head. I don't think it's the right one because I don't think it's love. I don't know. I don't think I'm going to get this.
Yeah, I can't either.
Yeah, I don't think so. Irby?
It was number four of that year. Was That's the Way Love Goes.
Oh, okay.
I was never going to get that.
I was never going to get there, but I do know that song. Okay. But that wasn't going to happen. Okay. What else you got?
So I've got a couple more R&B groups sitting at 5 and 7.
Okay.
The number 9, though technically the highest rap song, that was referred to as an American New Jack Swing group from Harlem.
Huh?
Oh.
Exactly.
Oh. Hang on. Is this the one that...
And then...
Oh, damn it. I know this song. I can hear it in my head. Ugh. At least my guess. I can hear my guess in my head.
How did you get that out of what he just said? A jumble of words that I don't understand. Okay, so we're looking for a rap song.
Yeah,
The
one I'm thinking of was in Nothing But Trouble, the movie Nothing But Trouble, which is around this time, and that seemed to catapult it up. Oh, wow, man, I'm blanking.
I guarantee you, whatever this is, I own the single tape of it. I'm just not aware of what it is yet.
Is that the name of the song? It's the Humpty Hump song.
No, that's earlier.
That's earlier?
Yeah.
The Humpty Dance? Yeah,
the Humpty Dance.
This is too late for Naughty by Nature, too. So
damn it.
For OPP. So,
love that song.
I'm looking for... Do we have a hint?
Aside from... New Jack Swing group from that. It's
yeah, that did not. That was just like you were just saying words.
So this is the lead single of this group's second album. It was released in August of '92. The album was called Hard or Smooth. Take that how you wish.
Yeah, I got nothing on that.
And the song is kind of inappropriately related.
Inappropriately related. Okay, so the material is somewhat inappropriate. Is the title inappropriate or just...
The title, yes, but compared to some of the names of songs nowadays, this would be PG.
This was pre-explicit label on CDs, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, if it helps, the same Dirty Mind stuff will help you get number 5 as well, because it's basically the replacement word for what we can't say up here.
Wow, that doesn't help me either.
Yeah, none of that helps.
Since you won't get there, number 5 while y'all are thinking about this one would be the American R&B group Silk and their single Freak Me.
Oh, yeah, I was never
going
to get that.
No. Neither was I.
Okay, so what are we... Okay, so we're missing 9.
7, 9, and 10.
Seven and ten.
Seven is another...
song that's not really dirty, but was dirty at the time. Right?
Yeah. 10 is going to be even harder because it's by a Canadian reggae musician / rapper / singer.
Oh my God, Snow.
There you go!
Informer.
Informer, that's, number 10. Well done.
That's the one she gets.
Literally only one Canadian rapper in history.
Boom.
So
we haven't had a Canadian rapper since the Canadians won the Stanley Cup. Got it.
Someone is going to tweet at me tomorrow that there's... I'm
going to
get 50 Canadian rappers I've never heard of tomorrow. Just watch.
While you're working on 9, number 7, the group, this is their debut single, an American R&B soul quartet, released in 1992.
Soul quartets.
They were discovered as a group that's singing on the Howard University campus. Hmm. That helps or not?
Huh. No. But
it does have the word love in there. As our final fourth word, love in there.
Oh, wait a minute. Is this an a cappella song? It's completely a cappella, is it not? Shy. S-H-A-I, shy.
Yes. Oh, they are. Very, yes. Sorry. I'm sorry. Yes, it is an a cappella song. Wow. I did not know that.
What's it called? If I Ever Fall in Love.
There you go. If I Ever Fall in Love by
Sky. I had the single tape. Mm-hmm.
Had the single tape. There you go. All right. So, number nine, any last, if I give you the group, will that only hurt the case?
Probably.
Well, I don't know. Tell us the group or we're not getting there.
It would be Wreckix and Effect.
Oh, Wreckix and Effect? Oh,
Wreckix and Effect.
Bump Shaker.
There you go.
I did have the single tape. Wreckix and Effect. That's right.
And definitely the PG version of some of the names of songs these days.
Can you imagine, like, kids today, if we were like, it was so bad because these guys were like, all I want to do is a boom, 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 and a zoom, zoom, zoom. And kids today would be like, are you serious? It was so bad at the time.
So yes, there's your top 100 music. All right, so movies.
Ooh, okay. 1993. Okay. Movies in 1993.
All right, we can't connect any of them to the songs, right? Because the Bodyguard songs come later.
But there is one in here that, a little surprising, none of its songs.
Oh,
its songs would have been later. It would have been earlier. There you go. That's why.
Oh, Forrest Gump.
No.
Yeah, that wasn't
good idea.
That was 94, maybe. Forrest Gump.
Forrest Gump was 94.
I don't know. I just heard songs earlier in that era, and I immediately went to Forrest Gump. This is Jurassic Park, though, isn't it? I mean,
there's number one.
It's got to be Jurassic Park.
Greatest movie ever made. Might be a little biased, but I don't care. This is my segment. Greatest movie.
Absolutely
ever made.
Not the greatest movie ever made. It is an excellent movie. Movie that has withstood the test of time despite its terrible special effects. It is, however, not
Stop
the
it!
Greatest movie ever made.
Those effects at the time were amazing. We saw dinosaurs on TV. Okay.
That's what I mean. It has stood the test of time. Despite they look bad now, and yet they still kind of hold up. You know what I mean? Excellent movie.
Yes,
definitely top 20 for me. Absolutely not the greatest movie ever made.
See, we've been through this. We've been through this on this show. The greatest movie ever made was Major League 3 Back to the Minors.
No, the greatest movie ever made was Full Throttle.
No. Second movie. Second best. Major League
Back
3
to
Back
Irby
to the Minors.
Segment. Jurassic Park is the greatest movie ever made.
Okay. I want to make an argument for another movie that I would contend is one of the greatest movies ever made that I think is from this year, The Fugitive.
Ooh!
Number two! Good The movie. Fugitive!
Well done! Well done!
Damn! There you go. One of the best lines of, I didn't kill my wife! I don't care!
I don't care!
That's a great movie. I may have to watch that movie.
Sidebar. If you have not read it, read Lindy West's Shit Actually, which is just her like riffing about movies mostly from this era, in which she rates everything on a scale against The Fugitive, which she argues is the greatest movie ever made. It is a tremendously good book. Like, even as not a movie person, I thought it was great. It's hilarious. And everything is based off a scale of, is this better than The Fugitive? Incredible.
That's awesome.
I bought The Fugitive recently for like $10 on Amazon Digital, too. Just,
you guys, the depth of my obsession with Harrison Ford at that point in time, I was like 11 and I loved Harrison Ford because of that movie.
Oh, well, there you go. Irby, I believe this was I don't know exactly know where, but I know that this was either like, you know, the beginning or the middle of a big Robin Williams boom.
Ooh.
Okay. So.
Wait. He's on here twice.
So one of them is Aladdin. Okay.
Aladdin at number 8, and there was the musical one, because all the songs. But Aladdin came out November of 92.
Right.
So all the songs would have been in 92.
That makes sense. Okay, now I understand why you said that. Okay.
Was it
Robin Williams?
Wasn't that also Hook?
I think it's Mrs. Doubtfire.
It could be Mrs. Doubtfire, too. I was thinking Mrs. Doubtfire or Hook, but I wanted to start off with Hook.
Which one came first? Wasn't Hook earlier? I think Hook is before Mrs. Doubtfire.
Hook might have been 91, 92.
Yeah, that's the problem is I'm pretty sure it was before, but I'm not necessarily sure that means that which one is this year. It's one or the other. It's got to be one or the other.
Yeah,
I can't think of anything else, Robin Williams.
You guys are doing good.
Jumanji?
Hook came out before Mrs. Doubtfire, if that helps.
What about Jumanji?
But Jumanji might have been more 95.
Okay, so if Hook was before Mrs. Doubtfire, then I'm standing by Mrs. Doubtfire, I guess.
I think it's Mrs. Doubtfire, because Jumanji was more towards the 95. I think it was 94, 95.
Okay.
For Jumanji.
Mrs. Doubtfire.
You guys are correct on Mrs. Doubtfire, number 5.
All right. Okay. What else was there?
So it's up 1, 2, 5, and 8. Definitely the ones I thought y'all would get.
1, 2, 5, and 8. Okay. So, man.
Little Giants?
No. Oh,
what about A Few Good Men?
Ooh. Maybe.
Close. So A Few Good Men, unfortunately, it was released December 11th of 92. So because of that, it does hit 13th here. It is 13th.
Okay.
So, but unfortunately, because of release date.
I'm sorry, I lost your set of steak knives. I love that movie.
Oh, it's a fantastic movie. All right, is there a Batman? One of the Tim Burton Batmans?
Yeah, that's a good guess.
So this would, I'm assuming this is going to be off your time. No Batmans. We do still have another thriller suspense in the kind of fugitive type realm. Couple of those. Hmm. With a couple of actors who have released movies this year.
Actors who released movies this year. All right, I'm not.
2022. I'm sorry, 2022.
Okay, I don't know about any movies that came out in 2022 except the Knives Out sequel. So I'm gonna need a new hint.
Okay. Can't tell you the main person.
93. That was Lethal Weapon 3, wasn't it?
Oh, that seems right.
No, not top 10. I'm looking.
Or not.
Sounded right. Sounded right, but no W there.
All right, give us a hint. We're not doing very well. Well, we got 1 and 2.
No, you get
1, 2, 5, and didn't we get 4 of them? Wait, what was
that? 7.
You got 4.
1, 2.
No, you got 5 and 8. You got Jurassic Park. The Fugitive, okay. Mrs. Doubtfire, and Aladdin.
Okay.
So, I'll give you the hint because y'all did great on the Robin Williams and had fun with that. Tom Hanks is in the top 10. Okay,
Tom Hanks, but not Forrest Gump. Philadelphia?
Possibly.
Sleepless in Seattle.
Ooh.
I don't know. It's one of those two.
It is one of those two.
Okay, I don't know which one.
Narrowed it down. That's good enough.
You know what? I think I'm gonna go with. Man, those were so close to each other. One could easily be 92, the other one 93 or 93, 94. I'm gonna go with Philadelphia. That's my guess.
Try again.
Damn it.
Okay.
Sleepless in Seattle was four. Number 4. Sleepless in Seattle.
Okay.
Here's another fun hint. So number 11 was the thriller suspense The Pelican Brief, starring Denzel Washington and Julia Roberts. Mm-hmm. Number 3, very similar, but beat it out.
Oh, The Firm. The other John Griffin.
The Firm. There you go.
Great movie.
Starring Tom Cruise.
Yeah. Oh, but more importantly, Holly Hunter. Supporting performances of all time.
It was outstanding.
Very good.
It was tremendously good.
Very outstanding performance. I agree with
you. Yeah. Also, Gene Hackman, everything with Gene Hackman is good. It's just a rule. That is a law.
That also might have been the last movie before Gary Busey lost his mind.
Oh, you know, I think you're right. Another great performance in that movie. Probably never happened again. Yeah. Then he was the mugshot guy after that. That's right.
Mugshot. All right, so y'all, 1 through 5 now. We got 6, 7, 9, and 10. So 6 is a drama. A drama. Good handful of people that are still making movies, but the lead actor was getting a little older. Probably the generation before us. Number 7, the main actor, is still in movies today, still directing movies today.
Clint Eastwood.
In Line of Fire.
In the Line of Fire, number 7.
Oh, another reason for me to hate Clint Eastwood, because I really did not like when his friend died, his little assistant guy died.
Yeah.
That guy, I was very angry about that. Oh, wow. Every time someone brings up Clint Eastwood movie, I have another reason to hate Clint Eastwood. This is very productive.
Yeah, but
okay. Well, we're here for you.
You're also glossing over an outstanding performance by John Malkovich in that film.
That's fair. That I'm was not giving Clint Eastwood credit for that, though.
Man.
That is John Malkovich on his own. Clint Eastwood, yeah. Zero credit.
Yeah.
But, that's fair. Respect to John Malkovich for being just beyond creepy. 100%. Totally agree.
All right, so there's your 7. So we got 6. 9 and 10. 9 and 10, the hints I can give you there. 9's a pure, blown, all-out action, every sense of the word, action movie.
All right, well, which action star? Are we talking Stallone? Are we talking Schwarzenegger? Are we talking Bruce Willis?
Yeah. Yes, one of those three.
One of those three, okay.
Okay, which one? 90. That doesn't narrow my tell.
Is this the True Lies year?
Oh! It's got to be close to it.
It's close.
It is, or, that or, one is oh, close, oh, but no, not True Lies.
It's not True Lies.
Last Action Hero.
Ooh. That's about that time.
Yeah.
It is that time. Painfully, Last Action Hero finished 24th.
Well, that's just absurd.
So is this not an Arnold Schwarzenegger? Can we throw out Arnold
Schwarzenegger? You can throw out Arnold Schwarzenegger, yeah.
You left us with Bruce Willis and Stallone.
See, I was going to guess Eraser, but okay.
Demolition Man?
Ooh.
Demolition Man, is that what I heard?
Yes.
Yeah.
Very good guess. That was 22nd.
Oh.
22. Okay. Okay. Yeah. You're getting better because, you know, your punches are getting better here.
Wait, did I have the right guy? Demolition Man? Do I have the right actor?
Stallone?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right, so we have
your punches Stallone are getting better.
So, cliffhanger.
Ah!
Cliffhanger, number 9.
Yeah,
everyone forgets Michael Rooker, John Lithgow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
John Lithgow played the number, guy.
That's right. Number 10, family movie with an incredibly unrealistic ending. Like, unbelievably unrealistic. So much, and this should help you a lot, that my 11-year-old will not watch it because of how unrealistic the ending.
Yeah, Free Willy.
Boom! There you go. He'd be so proud of you.
I forgot about Free Willy. Until you mentioned him, and I'm like, what's an animal movie that's wrong? Oh, Free Willy. Yeah. You can't just let Shamu out of SeaWorld into the ocean.
Well, not even that. It's the jump. Maybe the air that he gets in the jump. Like, no, he wouldn't. But whatever. The last one in here.
A good movie.
No. Doesn't stand up well. The last one in here, number 6, not one that was big for me. I don't know.
Was this drama?
Okay. Yes. So, starring Robert Redford, Demi Moore, Woody Harrelson.
Oh, Indecent Proposal.
I saw this in the theater when I was like not old enough to see it.
I was about to say, how'd you do that?
Indecent Proposal.
Oh, funny story. So I begged my mom to see it because it's what all the kids in my class wanted to see. And my mom was like, you're not allowed to go see this movie unless you go to see another movie that empowers women. This was what my mom told me because that's Joyce, right?
Yeah.
So awesome. I went and saw, and this is how I figured this out, because we went then a couple of weeks later as a family to see Last Action Hero. And the daughter kind of comes up as the hero in that one. So I told Joyce I was off the hook and she grudgingly agreed with me.
Well, so. I mean, you know what? You satisfy the demands.
I did. Yep. I met the requirements.
You did. You met the requirements.
Not at all what she intended. And I was like 10 years old, and I cannot believe she let me go see a movie where like Robert Redford and Demi Moore are like banging in a pile of money. But it's an interesting parenting strategy. She got her point across, put it that way.
So, to wrap this list up, we mentioned Pelican Grief at 11. You guys have, we got the top 10. Number 12, Groundhog Day.
Oh.
16, Cool Runnings.
Nice.
Never seen it.
18, Scent of a Woman.
Never seen that.
19, Rookie of the Year.
Oh, I love Rookie of the Year.
21, Dennis the Menace.
Oh, God, that was awful.
That was a movie?
It was awful.
20, yeah, it was. 27, not as popular back then, but boy, picked up later on. Nightmare Before Christmas.
Oh, another good one. Very okay. Good, yeah.
28, Made in America.
Oh, yeah. Ted Danson and Whoopi Goldberg.
Yeah. We have a bunch of sequels in here. 25, Sister Act 2. Mm-hmm. 30 was Beethoven 2. 31, Adam's Family Values. 32, Wayne's World 2. 33, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 3.
Nice.
Wow.
Nice.
And 39, Hot Shots Part 2. So,
that was the Hocus better Pocus. Hot Shots. That was the better
in there at 37. Shots. Yes. Robin Hood, Men in Tights, 43.
Oh, outstanding. Yes.
Yeah. And unfortunately, because of the world we live in, but it ticks up time later, sitting down at number 48, The Sandlot.
How was The Sandlot at 48?
So my guess is going to be just looking at this. It was an April release, April 7th release.
Oh, that should.
This is a kid's movie. Like, yeah. Why are you releasing a kid's movie in April?
Oh, that's a really good point.
That should have been July 4th.
Yeah, I mean, I do agree that Rookie of the Year is the better movie. Rookie of the Year is better than The Sandlot. I agree with that. However, they're both better than the ranking that they received.
Why yes.
Is a kid's movie in April? That doesn't make any sense. It's not even early enough for spring break. That's stupid. Oh, yeah. Because they wanted to release it at opening day. That's probably what it is.
Oh, God.
That didn't work as well as you thought it would.
No, it did
not.
No.
Clearly was not a great marketing strategy.
No.
It's like Rob Banford was there or something.
So there you go.
I'm just going to go ahead and blame Rob Banford for that, even though we had nothing to do with it. I'm just going to go ahead and do it.
You don't know that.
That's fair.
He probably was the reason.
I don't know that, you know, like he would probably refer to the baseball signed by the great Bambino as just a baseball, you know, kind of like his hunk of metal argument with the World Series trophy.
He would refer to it as signed by Baby Ruth.
Oh boy! All right. Anything else, Herbs?
No. You guys did very well. Very well. Good remembrance. Great job talking about a fun rivalry 30 years ago. Got that started. So let's flip the script, Niners. Let's win a home game.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to go ahead and disagree with you on that, but that's neither here nor there. All right. That's going to do it for us. We're out of here. Until next week, if you're not going to watch football, watch The Sandlot. It's not going to help its rankings from 1992 or 3, but hey, should watch it anyway.